How do you think Odo's look? You think it has to do a lot with Freddie, what he's been doing, or what is his key to success been?
Obviously, Freddie's a great trainer. I'm sure he's helped out. But I look at Cotto as, just getting back to the things that got him there. You know, I feel like he moved a little too much in the Gil fight. I don't know if that was Gil's physicality or the size imposing on him or what. But I think that the knockout kind of got people's minds away from that, attention away from that. Cotto can box very well, and he did. He boxed Gil very well. But I felt like he moved a little bit too much in the fight. And I start to wonder if that was because of Gil's size. And if somebody who knows how to impose his size better than Gil starts to put that pressure, will it force Cotto to move too much again? And eventually, does that catch up to you in the late rounds? You know, obviously, this is just me hypothesizing, me thinking offhand. But, the knockout of Gil, I thought, took away the attention from that because it was such a big knockout, such a big punch. But I start to wonder, would somebody like Canelo know how to back that one more using his physical size? And would he know what to do better than what Gil knew how to do, you know? So, I'm not saying Cotto doesn't have an answer for it, but I'm curious to see what that answer is when they fight each other.
What I'm curious about, how's your relationship with Freddie now? Is it still kind of...
I don't know. I said what's up to him at the Mayweather weigh-in, it was cool, So, I got respect for Freddie. I don't know his opinion on me.
You and me, we're banned.
Yeah, I got banned. But I wasn't training in wild card anyway. I didn't train in wild card since 2013, so, I don't know. I don't know that it made a difference if I got banned.
You're not losing sleep over being...
I haven't been in the gym. I mean, I'm on the other side of the country. What am I going to do,
Obviously, you're never scared to say what you feel. You know what I mean? Have you noticed so many repercussions throughout your career? Even as a boxer, commentator, does it scare you away from ever being 100% real?
I don't know. I feel like in the end, when you're real, the karma will come back and pay you back in a good way. You know what I mean? Like, look at my career. Yeah, I haven't had like an Oscar De La Hoya career, but look at the way my career turned out. I won two world titles. I got some of the best jobs in the sport. I made good money. I'm able to make a good living. So you know what? And I've been real the whole time. So I haven't even had to have the change for anybody or anything. So,
are you kind of happy you got that kind of training camp? Is all good enough? You need a bigger fight? Is this something you're kind of relieved about? How's it doing?
I don't know. I don't know what would have happened if I didn't get caught. I would have fought O'Connor and then maybe moved on to other things. I don't know how the O'Connor fight would have turned out. Who knows? You don't know. I'm not going to tell you everything happens for a reason because that's so cliche. But obviously the cut ended up being a blessing in disguise in some ways, because I got this big opportunity now, and obviously it's nothing to complain about.
Paulie, how much jewelry worth is on you right now? Like, do you need security when you walk through the hotel?
No, I don't need security.
Is it in the hundreds of thousands of dollars?
Yeah, it's good.
How
money.
Much?
It's good money. I left my bracelet at home, though. So my bracelet is actually worth more than all of them, but I forgot it at home.
So you're walking around now with $300,000, is that fair to say?
Yeah, close.
That's like New York money.
That's pretty cool.
I like my jewelry, man. I have a lot of jewelry, honestly. Maybe a little too much, But if things get bad, I can always sell my jewelry and I'll be living good again,
So Paul, you're talking to the fans, you say, probably talk about Pacquiao, but if he's fighting, he'd lose and all this other stuff. I mean, would you want to fight with Pacquiao? How do you respond to those people, man?
I don't think Pacquiao looks impressive at all once he's been ran the drug test, so I'm not against a fight with Pacquiao at all. I don't think there's anything impressive about the guy. I think he's a one-dimensional fighter once you ran the drug test. I think he's been fighting the same way for a long time. There's not really any new wrinkles to him, and that's why the fight against Mayweather was so one-dimensional and it was so one-sided. As I predicted, it would always be. I've never lost to a southpaw in my life, so I like my chances against Pacquiao.
So if they have a rematch, Mayweather-Pacquiao, what happens?
If they have a rematch, everybody wastes their money buying the pay-per-view again, and then everybody laughs at you, and then Paulie Malignaggi will laugh at you again because you got duped for 5 years and thinking this was actually the fight that was going to make a big difference. You got duped into paying $100. Well, you could have just listened to me the whole time. I would have told you exactly what was going to happen because it happened exactly. I don't know, he didn't have a shoulder injury. Why didn't he ask for a cortisone shot like a normal human being? When I got an injury, I asked for a cortisone shot. I don't ask for a toradol shot. Who asked for a toradol shot?
What's the difference, Fuzz?
Toradol, it numbs your body. NFL linebackers use toradol, man, to impact, so they don't feel the impact when they're banging into people. Who asked for a toradol shot? That's why you got turned down, bro. If you ask for a cortisone shot like a normal human being, you don't get turned down. Yeah, you got a fighter. USADA allows cortisone, bro, an injection of cortisone in your joint. Like, so
there's
nothing. Toradol
brings out aggression, too.
Yeah, Toradol brings out aggression. It's beyond me how every idiot out there can't figure this out. Because you don't have to be even remotely intelligent to figure it out. There was never an injury. It was just he had to make something up, so he had an excuse to ask. to see if he could get an toradol injection. So then, you know, if he could get it, then it could mask everything else. Then when he didn't get the toradol injection, he said, you know what, let's just go with the same excuse. Let's just say I had an injury the whole time. You have an injury the whole time. Why don't you use cortisone, bro? Like, that's what everybody else uses. When I got an injury, I've shot my hands up with cortisone.
Why didn't he disclose the injury?
Forget about that. You know, if you go into a fight with an injury, like, you're not necessarily going to disclose it. I mean, fighters have gone into fights with injuries. I'm saying he never had it. That's the problem. He never had it. He was looking for an excuse. He was looking for an excuse to find a way to put toradol in his body. So how are you going to ask for toradol in your body without an injury? Because it's going to come up in the random drug test. USADA is going to test you for it. So how are you going to explain toradol being in your system when they test you for it? You have to let everybody know. You have to include it in the list of things you're putting in your body, because that's how random drug testing works. You have to let them know what you're putting in your body. So you can't hide the fact that you're putting toradol in your system. So you have to actually let them know. So how are you going to let them know you're putting toradol in your system? You have to make up an injury. There's no other way to do it. You have no other reason to put it in your system. So you have to ask for them. So that's why you got turned down.
So there you have it, another great video for ES News. For ESNewsReporting.com, I'm Ellie Secback reporting, and you can follow me on Twitter at Secback, and you can follow me on Instagram at Ellie Secback.